Well, more bad news for PwC today as details around the tax scandal and its internal dealings have been aired to the Parliamentary Joint Committee on Corporations and Financial Services. Former General Counsel of the Big Four accounting firm Meredith Beattie kicked off the day directly contradicting evidence previously given by former Chief Executive Tom Seymour, with Ms Beattie claiming he was well aware of the tax scandal for some time.
Mr Seymour was well aware of the notices that were served, because they were served on Mr Kalija, who reported to Mr Seymour. It was a source of great pressure for Mr Kalija that he had these obligations to respond to the notices, and Mr Seymour was fully briefed on a regular basis in relation to this process.
Current Chief Executive Kevin Burrowes also under fire for not revealing he was being paid by PwC International in addition to his local salary until just days before it being disclosed to the parliamentary inquiry.
But I think for Mr Burrowes, the important thing for him is to lead the firm forward and, you know, and build the confidence and respect from the Australian firm so that it can go forward in a successful way. And so for me, and I'm not Mr Burrowes, I would regret that I had not made that information available sooner.
For more on all this, I spoke with Chair of that Joint Committee, Deborah O'Neill.
Well, thanks so much for covering this really important matter, Ingrid, and it matters to every Australian that we have people who are part of the fundamental financial services of this nation that are operating at the highest ethical standards. And what we have had confirmed today is that Mr Burrowes, who ultimately became the PwC Global imposed CEO, was actually in on the ground pretty early once the TPB findings about Mr Peter John Collins matters became public. And we've got a lot more clarity about Mr Burrowes' role, but we also have a lot more clarity about the role of Ms Diana Weiss, who is the Office of General Counsel for PwC Global. So the questions it raises for us is, like, who's really in control? We also know that Mr Burrowes, the current CEO, who was imposed on the Australian partners, only told a very small group of people in the Governance Council that he was being paid by PwC International an additional $1.2 million per annum plus a bonus on top of his $2.8 million role as the Australian CEO. He didn't let his partners know, and there are hundreds of them, but he also importantly didn't let a critical person in the middle of all this, and her name's Ms Jan McKay. She is the risk officer, and she's actually doing the work that the TPB asked of PwC to try and get them back on track. She's reporting conflicts of interest where things, you know, have to be declared. Somebody has to perceive there's a conflict of interest, then it has to be acknowledged, it has to be written up, and there needs to be a remediation to make sure that conflicts of interest don't exist. Well, she wasn't able to report the conflict of interest that is obvious to everybody else. Mr Burrowes is working for an Australian company at the same time as he's working for an international company, and he didn't declare to his own partners here in Australia that he had this relationship until the Senate forced him to do so. That is definitely not good governance. It's certainly not operating at the highest ethical standards. And it would appear that Ms McKay's role in reporting to the Tax Practitioner Board and complying with our regulations was compromised by Mr Burrowes in his role as the person representing PwC International. Not good. This is not good.
Yeah, and this is even post the scandal, as you say. This is somewhat recent. So do you get the impression that the Big Four, or PwC in particular, will start to take this seriously, or has been taking it seriously in recent times?
Well, I think that there's been a hope that business as usual might just continue and that the Senate inquiries would just disappear and they could go back to the way things have always been. But I think what we've seen in the particular case of PwC is sufficient detail emerge about the shadowy practices that are going on inside there, about the limited capacity of governance boards to actually even get the truth and share the truth with their partners, that we can really no longer consider that it's possible to go back to the old ways. There has to be a very significant shake-up, because these big companies, PwC and EY, Deloitte and KPMG are fundamentally important to the proper functioning of our markets. And every Australian who has superannuation, and thank God that's millions of us now, we require that whole system to be working really, really well. And these four big companies and a few others are embedded in there. They are supposedly the governance standard setters. They are supposedly the truth tellers, the ones who let us know that companies are doing the right thing, looking at them, auditing them, making sure that their governance is in order, that their books are in order, so that informed decisions can be made by people who are investing through their SMSF or through a retail or through an industry fund, super, to get our funds moving into the companies that are transparently known to us. So these guys, these PwC, EY, Deloitte, KPMG, they're really, really an important part of the financial architecture. And I think we've seen with PwC, they've been found terribly wanting and resistant, not only to regulators like the ATO and the Tax Practitioner Board, but also to the Senate, thinking that they can just claim confidentiality of their materials and not provide it to the Senate. Well, the law doesn't work that way in Australia, and it's a very important moment for not just those four companies, but for corporate Australia to understand that corporate Australia's success abides in the context of a great democracy that's functioning according to the law, and that the Parliament can call for documents and call for individuals. Mm. Indeed, we can demand that they come and that they provide us with these documents. And that's the point that we're at now, because we haven't had the fulsome response from PwC that we required. It's taken some time and we've tried to be patient, but now it's time to cough up. Mm. PwC has to come forward and give the Australian public the documents that they seem so determined to hide.
Do you think a breakup of these firms would solve some of these outstanding issues?
Well, certainly that's some of the evidence that we've received. Now, we've had a range of views. We've had Professor Fells and we've had Graham Samuel come on and come to the committee, and they've indicated different ways in which the companies might need to be changed in terms of the structure, and that's a live debate, and the committee will certainly make recommendations around that. But one thing's for sure, that, you know, a partnership of 900 up to 1,000 people doesn't operate anywhere near what it might operate as if it was limited to 20, which was the original construction of what a partnership might be. That law was changed under the government of John Howard. These entities have grown and grown and grown. The partnership structure, which is supposed to make everybody responsible, is clearly failing. How can you be responsible? How can you even consider looking at a conflict of interest if the chief risk officer isn't even told the necessary information? And if people who are supposed to figure out there's a conflict of interest haven't got the ethical discernment to figure out that for themselves. So there are fundamental flaws in the way that the system is operating currently that will need to be addressed, and whether that's by structural separation or operational separation and a suite of other measures around it, we can't just continue as it's been. It's too much of a risk.
Deborah O'Neill, we really appreciate your time on the program today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much.